Well, here we are again. I'm back with Velda Schirhart, who is the director of All Our Healing Ministries here at Whole Life Ministries. And Velda, we see so many nuggets when we get to teaching like this that we learn ourselves. And we pray that. We always pray that beforehand, not only will you get a nugget, that we will get a nugget also. And God's always so faithful. It's amazing.
It is.
And we've been, for the last 2 weeks or so, we've been kind of going through different little processes in the scripture of healing and different people that Jesus healed, mm-hmm. and trying to get some nuggets that might apply to somebody, because we want to help people grab hold of this. Not only we want you to grab hold of it, bless God, we want to grab hold of it, because all of us, as Brother Hagin said, face the crises of life.
Right.
And so we need to have understanding of how you make this thing work, this thing called healing that Jesus provided for us. Remember, he went around teaching, preaching, and healing. And if your church does not teach healing, you need to be talking to them about it. You need to be teaching healing. Now, let's see, Bill, a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the guy that was paralyzed and had four crazy friends who let him down through the roof, mm-hmm. and all the doctors of the law were there, and everybody was around, and the Bible says that the power of God was there to heal them too, but them didn't get it.
Them did not get
they
it.
They did not get it.
They weren't willing.
One person, the room was so packed that they had to take the guy up on the roof, mm-hmm. take off the roof, and yet one person got it. That's the one who pressed in. That was just absolutely determined to
right.
go after what he knew God provided. Then we came back and we talked about Jairus, and we're going to pick up again with Jairus today. And we're in the Mark chapter 5. We talked about the ruler of the synagogue and all that he had to go through. And being, I kind of relate him to being like a pastor of a church, or,
right.
or being somebody that's, well, pastor of a church is a mm-hmm. very good thing. That you got all these people around you that maybe your denomination does not believe in healing. Maybe they don't teach healing, so therefore you don't teach healing. Or maybe because of the signs of the time and everything that's going on, you back away from healing. Because again, criticism comes to lots of folks who teach healing. But I'm telling you, Jesus taught healing. We've got to teach healing. And healing, and God, we serve an unchangeable God.
Yes, we do.
He has not
once
changed.
Once a healer, always a healer. Just like once the Savior, always the Savior.
So we talked about Jairus, who had the young daughter mm-hmm. that was sick and came to Jesus and asked him in the middle of a throng of people, would he please go to his house, lay hands on his daughter, and Jesus went.
Right.
But in between the time of him asking Jesus to go.
Uh-oh.
Something else happened.
Something else happened. A delay.
A delay
came
happened.
Along.
A delay. And the delay was in the form of somebody else seeking healing.
Right.
Who was going to press in and get what she wanted mm-hmm. at the same time. All right, let's look at it real quick. Like,
okay.
All right, we pick up Jesus is following Jairus. He's going home
right.
with him.
Going home
and
with him.
And it says, a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians, had spent all that she had, nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind, touched his garment, for she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be made whole. And straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked around about to see the one who had done this. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came, fell down before him, and told him all the truth. He said unto her, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace, and behold of thy plague. Now, Velda, we could stay on this one a long time.
A long time. So many things right. in this one.
All right, give me your first impressions.
Well, again, I keep coming back to this because as I have studied healing, as you have for mm-hmm. years,
right.
and the people that come to Jesus, mm-hmm. step number one, they come to Jesus. You don't usually see Jesus going seeking them out.
That's right.
They have to make a decision to come to Jesus, be willing to receive of Jesus. Mm-hmm. But there's always this common thread of what I refer to as uncommon courage.
Yes.
Jairus, we talked about it previously, mm-hmm. of the risk he took. Mm-hmm. This woman mm-hmm. was in such a situation that if she had been caught, because it was against the law mm-hmm. for someone with an issue of blood to be in public, mm-hmm. she could have been stoned to death. And of all
just for being out.
For just being out in the public. But she mustered up the courage mm-hmm. to come after Jesus. It's like, and we won't talk about him today, but I love the story of Bartimaeus, yeah. blind Bartimaeus, right. when everybody told him to shut up,
right.
that he wasn't worthy.
He screamed louder.
He just screamed louder. You know, it's like, you can't tell me what to do.
Right.
I'm going after Jesus.
Right.
But we find that element over and over again mm-hmm. of the courage to pursue, to go after Jesus, to know he's the answer. He is the solution. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. He is the
right,
healer.
Right.
So that's what I see in both of these. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's coincidence or happenstance that these two, they could have been recorded separately.
Absolutely.
But they're recorded together because they both demonstrate this courage. They
right.
both demonstrate determination. They both are in desperate situations.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This woman, his daughter, Jairus, his daughter was at the point of death. This woman's been sick for 12 years and nothing has helped.
Right.
They're desperate, but they're determined.
Matter of fact, they're so desperate since she's been to every doctor in town, so to speak. And listen, let me say this up front. We believe in the medical profession. Velda's an RN. We believe in the medical profession. And so we ask you to stay with your doctor. We never tell people to throw their medicine away or anything like that. Work with your doctor. But just learn the power that the doctor is to put it together. Jesus is the healer.
Right. I used to tell the docs that I work with that, you know, they all worked for the great physician.
Amen.
They're tools, they're instruments, they're servants unto him, whether some of them realize it or not,
right.
they're just carrying out his work.
That's right.
So, and they're doing the very best they can.
Amen.
But we all know, like this woman went to all these different doctors, mm-hmm. spent everything she had, mm-hmm. and she was no better. We know that today.
Right.
There are people that go for this treatment, that treatment, the other treatment, and they don't recover. They don't get healed. They mm-hmm. don't get well. But we never, now this is a nugget for you, we never diminish the medical profession.
Right.
But if we have one person that comes
Come on.
And standing and believing God for their healing, and for this reason, that reason, whatever reason, it doesn't manifest in them, well then healing's not for today.
That's
or
right.
maybe God didn't want you healed, or maybe God's trying to teach you something through this
right.
sickness. But we don't do that with the medical profession.
Come on.
You know what we say in the medical profession? And it holds true because we talked last time about faith.
Yeah.
Jesus follows our faith.
Right.
As far as we're willing to go in it, he's willing to
mm-hmm.
go. But what we say in the medical profession, when we've done everything we know how to do,
mm-hmm.
and say, for instance, we lose that patient, we say the patient did not respond to the treatment.
Right.
We never say the treatment just didn't work.
Right.
And so, but why?
And we don't
healing?
Kill the doctor.
And we don't go and we don't
criticize.
And we don't
call him a fraud.
And we don't persecute him.
Mm-mm.
We don't call him some charlatan.
Right.
None of that.
Right.
We say the patient didn't respond.
Right.
That's what we saw the other day with
right.
the Pharisees and
right.
doctors of the law. They simply didn't respond. Even
right.
though the power is there to heal. But at any rate,
that's a very good
story.
Point. It's a very good point. And it's a point that's making people absolutely not come to Jesus the healer.
Right.
And not believing in Jesus the healer.
Right.
And yet again, seek the healer, not healing.
Right.
And put Jesus first. But we want to use examples, again, that might give you a little nugget. And the woman with the issue of blood, you could just teach morning, noon, and night on it.
Mm-hmm.
And again, Jesus is on the way to Jairus' house. And we find out later that the servants of Jairus came back and said, don't even bother him.
Right.
Your daughter's dead. So here Jairus is on his way and, you know, Jesus is on his way. And then so don't even bother Jesus, you know. But in the meantime, this woman is in the crowd,
mm-hmm.
obviously had heard about Jesus. That's
right.
what we're trying to teach you. We want you to hear about the healer. We're here today to teach you because if you can hear about him and we can get you to really heal here, you can be healed, I promise you, because Jesus has made provisions. If you seek in, press in, keep the word of God in front of
right.
you. All the things that these people who got it did.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole point of expressing that to you is, here she is, she's been had this issue of blood for 12 years. We can't go in all details, we may leave some of the nuggets out. But the big deal is, this woman was on, she shouldn't even be out there. Jairus could have himself ordered for her to be stoned,
mm-hmm.
as you said.
Mm-hmm.
And here she had some things that happened, though, before she came, Velda. But while she was at home,
right?
While she was watching him on TV, so to speak,
when she saw Jesus was in town, right?
She made some decisions on her own, and we have said for years, healing is a decision.
That's right.
So, what happened before she got there? What got her there?
Well, number one, she heard about Jesus, and when she heard, obviously, she believed what she heard that he was the healer. Mm-hmm. But it also again came back to this part. I love this. It said, "For she said,
yes."
If I may touch the hem of his garment. See, she already decided, she made that decision.
Right.
I'm going after it. Once I get there, once I touch him, I will receive my healing. It came down to a decision. But this thing, when you really study it out, she didn't just say it one time.
No.
There's great power in our words. Mm-hmm. We form and shape our destinies by what comes out of our mouth.
I believe that's scriptural.
I think that is scriptural. The Bible says you're going to get what you say.
Life and death are in the power of the tongue.
Exactly.
Right.
But she just kept saying it. She kept talking to herself as she was making her way through that crowd. You can't tell me she wasn't in fear. Oh. You can't tell me she wasn't horrified that someone was going to point her out, call her out.
Right.
But what she did, she focused.
Mm-hmm.
And she didn't let all of these other things distract her and pull her off of her target, so to speak.
Right.
And I can just see her making her way, trying to go through the crowds, trying to be quiet, but saying to herself the whole time, if I but can touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. She stayed on track. She stayed focused.
You know, the thing that's so interesting here, Velda, to me, and as I say, we want to give you the nuggets and not get just totally sidetracked, but there's so many little rabbit trails you can go that have nuggets in it. And this woman, obviously, as you said, was desperate, but she was desperate.
This woman had been sick for a long time.
I mean, to risk her life like that in a huge crowd, and I'm sure she didn't know that Jesus was going to be with her, one of the rulers of the synagogue when she got there. But she had made her mind up about something else that's real interesting to me. There's nowhere in here that says the key to healing is to touch the hem of his garment.
No.
Now, there is scripture about the tallit, and that's obviously what Jesus had on.
Mm-hmm.
And there is scripture about the fringes on the tallit.
Correct.
The healing power of God, the little blue thread. That was the healing. She seemed to know that more than anybody. She knew it better than the doctors of the law who were in the story back over there with the guy that was let down through the roof. You've got all the doctors of the law, everybody who really knew the law and knew that Jesus would have a tallit on, of course. He would have the little fringes. They would know that healing was there, but none of them reached out.
No.
So this woman obviously knew about the word enough to put it, if I can put it that way, that she made a decision, this may be my last chance. I don't want to really bother him, but I do know that in this tallit that he's wearing, there's healing in those little strings, if I can get to him.
Right.
That's amazing for this woman to know that.
Yes, it is. And to think about not some big miraculous event, some showboat kind of thing.
Right.
I'm just going to slip through the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to reach my hand out. Mm-hmm. I'm going to touch the hem of that garment, the tallit, and his healing power will be sufficient to heal me.
Man,
that's amazing.
About faith.
That is faith.
And she set the parameters of how her healing was going to come.
Right.
Because it's not a common thing.
Right.
And even though it should be common from the Old Testament, to be honest, everybody should be thinking, let me just touch the hem of
it. But this is the only account in the entire Bible where somebody comes seeking to touch Jesus and receive from him.
Well, matter of fact, it's the only place in the scripture, and all of us need, we all say, I didn't feel anything when they prayed for him. This is the only account, Velda, in the entire New Testament where it says Jesus felt anything, any power go out of him, and it's the only account where it says the person that was seeking healing felt something herself.
Right.
Why in the world do we judge everything by feeling?
Well, you know, we've taught it for years. Healing is not a feeling.
No.
Healing is just a fact of God.
Mm-hmm.
And you can, all of these we've talked about, the man that ripped up the roof and was laid at Jesus' feet, Jesus never laid hands on him.
No.
He never touched Jesus. Jesus told him, clean up your bed and get out of here. Walk home.
That's right.
And now it was just a simple word. With Jairus, I'll come with you and I will lay hands on your daughter. Mm-hmm. With this woman, she determined, this is the way I'm going to get it. I'm going to touch the hem of his garment and I'll be healed. So it's you determine how you're going to get there. We alluded to that earlier.
Yeah.
But this is phenomenal faith.
Yes,
she didn't
is.
Go thinking, I'm going to go and tell Jesus. In fact, when he addressed her and said, who touched me? I could almost see her almost passing out, but like, oh my gosh, I've been found out.
Yeah.
But then she did tell him the whole story.
She did. All she wanted to do was she knew that this man was of God.
Right.
And knew that this man had the healing powers of God, because any person of God has the healing power of God in them.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit's in us today.
Right.
Any man and woman, but believers shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover.
Mm-hmm.
If we would just honor the God in people, we'd see far more healings taking place anyway. We wouldn't be running all over the place.
That's
we'd just get your neighbor who was born again and knew how to pray, and you saw they lived a holy, godly life, and you'd say, go agree with me.
Right.
Pray, lay your hands on me.
Right.
I'm going to receive this.
Or if you find yourself in a situation where you can't find somebody to believe and agree with you, of course, the Holy Spirit will always believe and agree with you, so you can still have two.
Absolutely.
But you can lay hands on yourself. If you are a believer,
yes, you can.
You can lay hands on yourself. You can take your body.
Right.
You are the master of your body.
Yeah.
Most people think that they're ruled by their body, but it's the other way around.
Right.
And you can, I've done that myself.
Oh,
I've told the account one time when I was stuck in the middle of a college town at 5 o'clock in the afternoon with crazy college students driving like maniacs down the road, and my knee just gave way on me and I couldn't walk out of the traffic. Well, I couldn't find a believer right then.
Right.
And I couldn't call you.
Right.
I couldn't do anything. But I'm a believer.
Right.
I have the power and authority of God living in me. Mm-hmm. I have faith and trust in that God said, believers lay hands upon the sick, they shall recover. And I simply reached down in the middle of the traffic with the cars zooming in front, the cars zooming in back. I laid hands on my knee and I commanded it.
Command it in the name of Jesus.
Jesus. That's exactly right. I commanded that knee to move and work. And you know what it did? Nothing. It didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
But so, you know what I did?
Right.
I did it again.
Amen.
See, that's determination.
That's what this woman did.
That's right. That's determination.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, did you, care if the people thought I was crazy talking to myself in the middle of the street? I wanted out of the street and I wanted my knee to work.
Right.
So I put my hands back on that knee and I said, I told you, in the name of Jesus, you work, you move.
Persistent.
Persistent, insistent, consistent.
Yes. Yes.
Three great words.
Yeah.
And I put my hands on there, and then by faith, for we walk by faith and not by sight. I didn't feel a thing.
Mm-hmm.
I did not feel some great surge of power.
Right.
I did not feel a sudden release of some great something in me. But by faith, I took a step, and I walked across the street and out of the traffic, got my car, and drove myself home.
Praise the name of the Lord.
It would work for me. It'll work for you. Amen.
I hope you got that. Hallelujah. You are never alone, and you don't have to go running somewhere to get somebody. You can do it yourself. But again, you have to understand that God's in you.
That's right.
And the healer is already inside of
you.
This woman, I'm telling you, this woman amazes
me.
She
is phenomenal.
Of course, you know, Brother Hagin taught, you remember the Lord said, say it, do it. And receive it, tell it. Say it, do it, receive it. And he said that the Lord told him if people would do that, do those four things, that they would be healed.
That's right.
They would be healed. This woman, I mean, she just did it. And she made up her mind, I will be whole.
Right.
Completely
whole. This is an interesting statement to me. Now, it said that the fountain of her blood drew up instantly.
Yeah.
It just dried up. It was gone.
Right.
But then in verse 34 of that chapter, Jesus says to her, daughter, listen to this, thy faith has made thee whole. Jesus didn't even take credit for it.
No.
He said, thy faith has made thee whole.
Yeah.
But then he goes on to say, I've always thought this was interesting. Now, go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, I thought she just got healed back here. Mm-hmm. But Jesus gives us a great principle here.
He does.
If you walk away and a symptom hits you,
yes,
don't get out of peace.
Right.
Don't get back into fear and anxiety and go, oh, no, it didn't work, or, mm-hmm, oh, no, it's come back. Mm-hmm. Don't do that. Stay in peace. Stay believing. I laid my hands on Him. I laid my hands on myself. I received the Word of God. I am healed.
Right.
You've got to hold on to it. Don't,
yes,
let go of your healing.
Right.
But then He said, and be whole. Now, we said a while ago, this woman's been sick a very long time,
right,
with chronic bleeding, multiple medical problems,
yes,
that I could explain to,
yes,
you, but I'm not.
Yeah.
And then, but there's a process. You can have an instantaneous healing,
right,
of a situation, but there's still recovery time,
yes,
for wholeness to come in.
Yeah, come on.
And that means nothing broken,
right,
nothing missing, nothing lacking in,
right,
you. In other,
right,
words, you're fully restored. You're better than you were before it all started.
Hallelujah.
Now, that's shouting ground.
That's a praise the Lord.
I don't know about you, but I know about me. I'm going to be made whole.
Be made whole. Hallelujah.
That's great news.
That is great
news. She was going to be fully restored in everything the enemy had stolen from her through sickness and disease, the years of pain, mm-hmm, and suffering and sickness and weakness, the isolation because she couldn't go out,
right,
and
right,
people couldn't come,
right,
into her.
Right.
She's going to be restored of all that money, I believe.
Yeah.
God said,
yeah,
I'm going to restore you.
Yeah.
You're going to get double for your trouble,
amen,
honey.
Amen.
And so,
come on, girl.
He said, go be made whole.
Yeah.
We stop sometimes. Mm-hmm. Well, I just feel better.
I feel better. And just thank God I can handle it. I'm,
right,
just better.
Right.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Thank God I've handled it. I mean, it's better. It's better. And thank God I can handle it. God, nowhere does it say, and you handle the rest of it.
No. He says, go all the way.
Yeah.
Be thou made whole. You know, somebody out there today listening to us,
yes,
you've come so far. But there's still more. God's got more for you. God wants you whole and complete, healthy, restored. There's a big difference in a healing and health.
Yes, there is.
And God wants us to walk in divine health.
Yes, He does.
Where we don't, you know, honestly, I believe, because I found it in the book, mm-hmm, that we can get to the point where we so live in that sickness and disease can bounce off of us, mm-hmm, when it comes at us. We can be made immune to it.
I believe that too. I mean, you have to believe it if you're going to read the Word.
Right.
And whether or not we move in it is one thing and the
other. That's another
whole
story.
But it is available.
Right.
It's, you know, no matter what, it is God has made everything. Matter of fact, that word whole, you know, when you go back and you look at it, because this Whole Life Ministries was built on that,
right,
word, our time's about gone. But anyway, the word whole, when you really, you know, tear it apart and exegete it and everything, it actually means back to God's original intent.
Wow.
God's original intent, talking about with the first Adam. His original intent. And God, so what are we saying? God thinks abundantly more about us.
Right.
And has provided abundantly more to us than you and I ever think about pressing in to get.
Right.
In other words, if you can think it and believe it and dream it, God has made a provision so that you can get it. But the problem is we stop short.
Right.
We stop short.
We limit God.
We limit God.
That's
God
exactly
does not
right.
limit us.
That's exactly right.
I mean, He's there on our side. Velda, thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, they've stolen our time and taken our time from us. But I want you to remember this. Jesus is still in the healing business. Lay your hands on yourself. Get in your church and ask them, would they please teach you some things about healing, hallelujah, that are straight from the Word of God. God is still in the healing business. He loves you. He's not mad with you. God is on your side, my friend. You can count on Him to be there when you need Him. He's always there, I promise you.